Mental health issues have dominated headlines like never before. The isolation of the pandemic, the disease of addiction, and our reliance on the digital world for social interaction through our never-ending scroll through life is starting to show some detrimental signs in adult mental health. Now imagine being under 12 years old today and trying to navigate this world. Many educators and legislators are sounding the alarm because of the rise in mental health problems that stem from school lockdowns and navigating anxiety plus stress that we as adults have resiliency to. Kennedy Krieger Institute specializes in the special needs of children, whether it's physical or psychological. I invited psychologist and behavior analyst at the Institute, Dr. Matt Edelstein, on the show today to talk about how to spot children in crisis, what types of mental health services are available for them, and some tips for parents to help their child. Thanks for joining me today, Dr. Edelstein, and welcome to Maryland Perspectives.
Thanks so much for having me.
What are the main culprits that are making professional child care workers worried about children's mental health today?
Yeah, I think there are a couple pieces here. The first is some of the isolation that's happened as a result of the quarantines and virtual schooling that's been necessary during the pandemic, but has certainly limited some of the social emotional growth of children. The other piece, I think, is this collective stress that you mentioned. Right, our kids are smart and they understand when their caregivers are under stress. That actually can impact their functioning as well.
So what are some things that children exhibit if they are scared or anxious because of stress that are not quite normal?
Well, you know, every child is different and a lot of this depends on their developmental level and their functioning level before the stressful event. So for younger kids or for kids who are or maybe developmentally younger than their chronological age, you may see externalizing behaviors, right? Tantrums, emotion dysregulation, crying, sometimes things like aggression and disruptive behavior. Older kids or kids who are maybe faring a little bit better may be more withdrawn or they may be more likely to talk about some of the things that are bothering them, even if it seems like they're talking in broad general statements.
Well, and that seems to me the trick of it, right? Because having a simple conversation about managing stress or emotions as a parent with a child that's preteen or younger, you can't rationalize with a three-year-old, right? I hear that. It's an old cliche. How can parents have these simple conversations? What are some good conversation starters?
Well, I think there are different ways for children to learn. And certainly our instinct is to teach and explain. But for younger children, they're much better at learning through experience than they are through explanation. So while our instinct might be to try to draw out their feelings through conversation, there might be better ways to do it, like creating enriched environments or creating some opportunities for kids to play and feel safe and comfortable with activities they enjoy doing. I think that thinking about increasing the types of positive experiences that kids are having might actually be better in some ways than trying to talk to them about complicated topics.
Right. And those group activities where they don't feel like they are isolated, family trip or something along those lines. Before the pandemic, we were talking about screen time with children and how they're spending more and more of their days actually in front of a screen. And of course, being remote for school, this has been brought up time and time again. So what kind of impact has this been having on early childhood development? And what are some ideas of how much time a child should spend in front of a screen?
I think, again, this really depends on the child. There have been some ways that screen time has increased our ability to have good social interactions, particularly for kids for whom social interactions can feel more challenging. So I don't want to say that screens are universally bad. As with everything, moderation is key. I do think that a lot of screen time can be problematic for a lot of our kids, particularly because our brains need motor development and our brains need lots of different types of contact with stimuli in the environment in order to really develop appropriately. So we want to make sure that if our kids are on screens because they have to be in school or they have to be doing virtual learning, that we're trying to balance that time with outdoor activities or other types of tasks that can engage their motor skills and their language skills and other things that might be lost on a screen.
Well, and then you start getting into developmental milestones, right? What a child, and like you said, every child is different, obviously, but there are some key developmental milestones that children should be reaching at a certain point in their lives. What are some of these milestones, and how do you know if a child is not meeting them?
Yeah, I think a lot of the milestones depend on the age, obviously, but there a lot of them are social in nature, right? So when you think about milestones around, you know, a year, you typically think about language and communication, right? Waving or simple words or phrases like mama or dada or understanding the word no. Those are things that certainly we want to look for as our child is interacting with their environment. But there are other more telling cognitive milestones like looking for things that might be hidden, like a toy under a blanket or something like that, or also some of their movement and physical milestones like standing and walking and drinking from a cup without a lid. So there are a lot of things that we can be looking for that are not going to be just limited through the screen use that our kids are engaging with. Obviously, as kids get older, they're going to be engaging in more sophisticated language, have more complex motor movement, and their understanding of more complex thoughts is going to be evident. So I think parents who are worried about this, certainly there are people like us at Kennedy Krieger who are happy to meet with families and to do a more formal evaluation. But there's a lot of information from reputable sources like the CDC that parents can use as a basic checklist to check to make sure that their child is on track.
In your experience, your years of experience being a psychological and behavior analyst for children, when should a parent be worried enough about a child to seek professional treatment? And I'm talking about mental health, like a counselor or a psychologist. There's still a lot of stigma kind of wrapped up in that for adults. And how do you do that with a child?
Yeah, that's a great point. So I think a parent at any time is welcome to seek support. And really, it depends on the parent's own experience with children. And you know, certainly we find that parents who are new to parenting might be more nervous or reactive because they just don't have that experience. But, you know, certain types of behaviors might clue us in that more support could be warranted. Things like delays to some of those important milestones that I was just talking about, like language and motor movement. As kids get older into ages 2 and 3, getting them toilet trained typically is a part of that early childhood learning. And so if you're finding that kids are having trouble there, that's another area where you might seek professional help. I think the biggest message, though, is if your child is having problems such that it's impacting the family's functioning, that could be enough to seek out support. And sometimes the recommendations, the strategies that we use are relatively simple. They're just not something that a parent might know on their own. Things that come to mind are things like sleep problems or maybe picky eating or tantrums that seem excessively long, where children have trouble calming themselves down after a few minutes. Those are things that can really impact a family's quality of life. And so if it feels like things start to feel too overwhelming and parents don't quite know how to manage those things, that's where we tend to find a lot of those early initial referrals.
So do we have mental health services available in Maryland for children that may not even have adequate health insurance? I'm thinking about low-income families that may be having some problems. I know, and this is sort of an aside, but I did go to counseling as a preteen, and it really just made a huge difference in my life and made me kind of think more about that. So I feel bad for parents that may not have adequate health insurance. Are there some services here in Maryland that could help them out?
There certainly are. You make an excellent point that these are services that should be available to every family that feels that they could benefit from them, regardless of their social, economic, or financial situation. So one example is right here at Kennedy, the site that I work at right here in Baltimore City, we are a site that sees families with state-sponsored insurance or Medicaid. And that's the bulk of the types of families that we see. Obviously, there are a lot of different reasons why a family might be on Medicaid or might need state insurance, but those families are able to get the same quality of care as families with any other type of insurance. I know at the Institute, we make a point of being available to all kinds of different people with different financial circumstances. There are also some online resources that you could pursue that will help you sort through providers based on the insurance type that you have. So I know, for instance, Psychology Today has a filter where you can you can explore different clinicians based on your insurance and other types of details that might be important to you.
Okay. And I'll make sure I'm going to do a little research on my own and find some of those links so that we can get those up on the website as well.
Sure.
To close out, I'd like to maybe go out on a high point. Obviously, we've seen some shootings at area high schools. Gun violence has been a huge issue for youth. Baltimore City, we're seeing a lot of violence there as well. Is the news about youth mental health all bad?
I don't think it's all bad. I like to think of myself as an optimist. Certainly, there are incredible stressors out there for children, and we don't want to for a moment diminish how impactful they can be on their development. But I will also say that kids are amazingly resilient. With the right types of supports, kids who've had some of these negative experiences can certainly bounce back. The nature of being a child is that the brain is still learning and developing. And so I like to think that everyone still has a shot to reach their potential, regardless of what some of those early experiences are.
On that positive note, I want to thank you, Dr. Matt Edelstein, who is a psychologist and behavior analyst at the Kennedy Krieger Institute. Thank you so much for taking some time and talking to me today to shed some light on what children are going through in these unprecedented times, and also to thank you for the caregiving that you give at the Institute.
My pleasure. Thanks so much.